Christmas. And thank you for giving up your busy holiday season to join us. Concerning the minutes of the previous meeting, are there any additions or corrections to those minutes?
I move they be accepted.
Before you move that, I do have one correction. On page 9, it says, Mrs. Guthrie said that next time we would like to hear more about the green belt. This is about Stonegate 3 or 4. And we have a great concern about traffic on Mitchell Road. She also said it would be nice to hear about a 50-foot right-of-way between Stonegate and Dyer Pond Road for vehicular use. I think that was for emergency use. The record will show, instead of vehicular use, if you could just...
Is that on November 21st?
Page 9, November 21st, and I can show you just where it is.
Oh, I submit it.
Since I spent months stating that I did not want a connector road at that particular area, it certainly should be emergency, right? Thank you. Do I hear a motion to accept the minutes as amended?
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
I'd like to appoint Judith Wyman and Steve Etzel regular voting members. Okay. Thank you. The first order of business is, the correspondence. I always forget the correspondence.
Mary?
Yes?
We didn't...
Need to vote.
Vote on minutes.
Yeah.
Approval
could
of
you,
the minutes.
Could you vote now on the approval
yes.
of the minutes again?
Yes.
Okay. You both agree?
Yes.
All right. That's fine.
Oh, I thought we had to forget.
On the correspondence this evening, November, an issue of the Maine Townsman, the DEP sent an issue of profiles on scrap tires and white goods. COG sent a notice about the annual legislative dinner. November 17th, COG sent a notice about mobile home park laws. The Natural Resources Council of Maine sent a notice regarding the recycling law. November 14th, the Maine Audubon Society concerning Earth Day 1990. In November, The DEP sent a notice regarding issue profiles on regulation of dams. COG concerning the use of clustering to preserve rural character, and they announced that there would be a speaker on December 20th on this topic at Bates College. November 29th, a letter from Louise Sullivan of Two Lights Road regarding the intersection of Two Lights Road and Route 77 and drainage and safety problems on that road, which also enjoys pedestrian, bike, and horse traffic as well as vehicular traffic. Mrs. Sullivan is opposed to a connecting road between Broad Cove and Two Lights Road. December 12th, a letter from Henry Adams of Main Street 90 regarding Century 21 Balfour office building and the need for low shrubs to form a buffer zone between the parking lot and the sidewalk. On December 12th, Jerry and Sharon Murray of 320 Ocean House Road sent a letter regarding serious flooding problems and a stormwater which should be channeled to the proper storm drains. This would concern the Century 21 Balfour application before us. December 18th, Eleanor and John Watson concerning an increase in traffic from the Highlands. December 19th, from the town attorney, Monahan, Leahy, Hochadell, and Libby regarding dead-end roads. December 18th, a report from Norman Doe Associates regarding wetlands in the Highlands development at Broad Cove, and Steve will tell us more about that later on. And from the Lincoln Institute of Land Policy, a notice on affordable housing. So that's the correspondence that I always forget. Welcome, Ivan.
Thank
The first thing on the agenda this evening is a public hearing regarding Peter Rummery's application for a public access waiver for two lots at 216 Spurwink Avenue. Before I open up that public hearing, I would like to invite all members who wish to speak about this of the public to come forward after you address the chair and give your name and your address, and try not to repeat what your neighbor has said, and try to limit your statement to 2 or 3 minutes if you can squeeze it all in. So at this point, I will open up that public hearing, and maybe Mr. Rummery, you would like to start by just explaining what you want to do there.
Thank you, Madam Chairwoman. My name is Peter Rummery. I live in Cape Elizabeth on Fafuta Drive. My intent is to open up a public... I'll speak a little louder. To open up a portion of my property with a public access way to service two existing lots of the subdivision, several units of which I own. I could regurgitate what I've spoken about through several meetings. We bought our present home in 1963, which is on Fafuta Drive. It is one of the lots of this subdivision. Then in 1969, we purchased the rest of the subdivision that was not already built upon as an investment at that time for ourselves, our future, and our children. And the time has come now where we would like to realize something from our investment.
Okay, Mr. Rummery. Thank you very much. Is there anyone here from the public who would like to comment on Mr. Rummery's proposal? Sure, come right up to the microphone and state your name and address, and we welcome you.
Thank you, Madam Chairman. My name is John Schnell, and myself, my wife Joanne, and I live at 214 Spurwink Avenue, and our neighbor, Urban Green, who is in attendance this evening, lives next door at 210. And we'd like to thank the Planning Board for allowing us this opportunity to become involved in this process and to also verbally express our concerns and our questions regarding Mr. Rummery's access road and other related questions. And I apologize for looking down at my notes because I can't keep all these things in my head.
That's quite all right. I can't even keep the correspondence in my mind, so.
Well, anyway, thank you very much for allowing us to be here and allowing me to speak this evening. Regarding the development plans Mr. Rummery may have with this land abutting our land at 214 and also Mr. Green's land at 210 Spurwink. We don't wish to stand in the way of Mr. Rummery and his right to develop his properties. We're only concerned that the Planning Board is satisfied with this particular proposal and also any subsequent proposals that would follow, and that these proposals are in accordance with the regulations and laws governing the development on the Cape. Since 50% of our property abuts Mr. Rummery's proposed road and development sites, we are concerned about the impact this is going to have on our property value. And we first expressed concern over this access road regarding the drainage problem from this access road down onto the side of our property that abuts the road, and also the rear of our property that abuts one of the proposed development sites. And then Mr. Rummery came back with another plan that included culverts. We're still a little confused as to how this is going to keep the drainage off of that back part of our land, our property, which abuts his property. The area down there is is very wet. As a matter of fact, it never dries during the spring, summer, or fall. We've lived at 214 Spurwink in Cape Elizabeth for 4.5 years, and during this time we've observed Mr. Rumry systematically mowing the vegetation on his land behind our property and Mr. Green's, and still after this alteration and removal of cattails and other marsh-like vegetation, the lands behind our property is still very wet and soggy year-round when it's not frozen, and it doesn't dry out. We have questions regarding the suitability of this low, very wet land as developable, and also questions regarding the drainage problems of this land. We also have questions past the access road issue regarding sewage and other utilities into these proposed development sites, along with questions regarding the intended type of development that Mr. Rumry intends. Does Mr. Rumry intend to ask for sewage connections? Does he propose septic systems? This raises questions in our mind as to the suitability of septic systems for these proposed sites. Will he ask for some type of variance regarding the number of sewage hookups in proportion to the amount of road frontage that he possesses now with his three? Also, what types of structures does he intend to build on these proposed sites? The actual number of proposed sites and structures in total, not piecemeal. In short, we would very much appreciate, if at all possible, in seeing a long-term comprehensive plan of his development intentions, and then we could gauge the impact this development would have on his land and the property of the abutters. The issue of buffering, we could hopefully address that also, and also perhaps the time constraints regarding the completion of any building that would take place on these proposed sites. And as this construction would be happening within around 100 feet of our house, we would have questions also as to the efficiency and the least disruptive manner as far as the construction of whatever development occurs. We just want to thank you again for the opportunity to address you and to express our concerns and also raise these questions. We're musicians. We're not engineers. We don't know. This is our first house, and we're real excited about being a part of the town and also just being a part of all this process. And again, we want to reiterate, we're not Mr. Rumry's enemies. We're not trying to stand in the way of him realizing any of his dreams. Mm-hmm. We just want to make sure that it's all done in accordance with the rules and the impact of all of we neighbors and abutting property owners. And thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Schnell. Thank you. Is there anyone else from the public who might wish to speak? Anyone else? Mr. Rumry, would you like to address any of the comments made by Mr. Schnell?
I certainly intend to abide by all the rules and laws that are in place at this time and will be. I always have and intend to. You people are an arm of the town, and you are making sure that people like myself do just that. The plans I have at present are to attain a public access for these two lots, and what I do with those lots when I hopefully pass your requirements is not firm at this time. Whether I build on them, whether I sell them as developable lots, whether I build for my children at this time, that is up in the air, and I do not have plans for my additional land at this time. That's all I can say.
How about the drainage issue? I jotted down a few things.
Well,
the drainage issue that Mr. Schnell mentioned.
I can appreciate his concern. Anybody would have concern. It has been addressed by your town engineer.
Mm-hmm.
And I have discussed this with him. We have both looked at the land, and the drainage is complied with as far as he and I are concerned, and mm-hmm. within the scope of what I plan.
Mm-hmm. Anyone else from the public? Hearing no one else from the public, I will close the public meeting, but don't go away, Mr. Rummery. We still need you. I think the planning board might have a few questions they might wish to follow up on. Anyone from the planning board with questions regarding this? Dick?
Madam Chairman, I've got a couple of questions. One of the things that Mr. Schnell had said, indicated, was that the land down there was very wet. And I had missed the site walk, and I understand it was and is wet on site. And one of the things that this, one of the issues that is facing this town now is a new wetlands ordinance that's under consideration by the town council, changes the basis of wetland delineation, determination, and the amount of fill that can occur in wetlands as a part of a normal building permit. And I think the current draft, unlike the draft that the planning board had, reduces that to 1,000 square feet rather than 1,500 square feet. There is a possibility that even if a public access waiver were granted by the planning board, that the wetlands, there is no determination of wetlands at this point by the planning board, and there are some very serious restrictions on the site. Wondering if you might comment on the issue of wetlands, what you've done to review wetland conditions there, and what you expect to occur if a public access waiver were granted.
Yes. The way I have read the town zoning, I did not read what you mentioned as a 1,500 square foot area allowable to fill. I read it to be 5,000 square feet per lot, and this has been referred to me by the building inspector and Jerry Daigle, whatever his position is.
Madam Chair, if I may,
sure,
it's 5,000, the current exemption is 5,000 square feet. That's correct.
This is easily complied with a, I hesitate to use the term of normal size home, but my home could fit on that size lot with shrubbery and driveway and so forth. The size of this lot, which is basically the size of all the lots in that subdivision, the 5,000 square feet is a sufficient size to accomplish building construction.
Let me follow up, Madam Chairman, if I might, on that. If the board were to vote approval for the public access waiver, that is not in any way, I don't believe, grandfathering these lots to the existing ordinance of 5,000 square feet. There is under consideration right now, and if we're expecting adoption within the next couple of months of a new wetlands ordinance that will dramatically limit the amount of fill that can be placed on a wetland for an individual building lot to 1,000 square feet. And you had indicated earlier that you didn't know whether you were going to build these yourself, whether you were going to have them built, whether you were going to save them for your children, or
mm-hmm.
or what you were going to do. When do you expect to be building on these?
To follow up what I said, I'm not sure I would be building. The reason I am looking for the public access way right now, frankly, is to realize some of what I perceive to have been an investment 20 years ago. In that light, I assume that something will be done with those lots very shortly. I may sell them to somebody to build upon. I may build a spec home on one or both of them. At this point, Dick, I don't have a firm plan commitment exactly what I'm going to do. They will be hopefully they will be built on within 6 months.
If the new wetland ordinance were passed in January, are you able, if that lot was, both lots were all wetlands right now, are you able to build on that with a 1,000 square foot filling restriction?
Well, the way I would read it, if that is considered wetland and you say only 1,000 square feet can be filled in, I assume that would include a foundation size. That's not a very big home. If I understand the zoning ordinance correctly, 1,000 square feet, I don't... Well, you might get a small size cape with a minimal driveway on 1,000 square feet. It might be done. What you hit upon is what has been happening for the past 20 years that I've owned these lots. The rules change. It has become ever more restrictive to build. Subdivision as laid out had 40-foot wide roads and a certain number of homes, and at the time and for many years these were legal roads. That law has changed. No longer is a 40-foot road legal. As you know, that the changes that have taken place, I have repeatedly told my family that what I perceive to have been an investment very easily could become worth very much less. It so happens that I wish to realize some of my investment at this time, and my assumption is that if I get a public access way now, and either myself or someone to whom I might sell these lots attains a building permit, that at the time that they get the building permit is the time whose laws are in force, if I make myself clear. Mm-hmm. If something changes in January, as things have changed, we have to deal with them at that time. 1,000 square feet does not allow a very sizable home, which might be restrictive.
Madam Chairman, just to clarify for the board and for the applicant, under the proposed wetlands ordinance draft, the exemption of 1,000 feet would only apply for landscaping or maintenance of existing residential property. So in this case, an undeveloped lot would have to go through the wetlands alteration process. Doesn't mean it couldn't be built upon, but if the person who is to do that sort of alteration, if there was indeed wetlands on the site, would have to meet all the standards and provisions of the new ordinance.
Steve, I'm just not clear on, would Mr. Rumery be able to build the road if he cannot get building permits? What's going to come before? If a waiver were granted, mm-hmm. and Mr. Rumery began to build this road and then could not secure building permits at a later date, what happens to the road, et cetera? What?
That's a good question. I'm not completely sure of the answer. I'm not sure if a building permit's needed for the construction of the roadway. If it started to involve construction on the site, my thinking is that it would, and therefore I believe that a building permit would be required for the road construction. One thing that I've talked to Mr. Rumery about was to make sure that if and when he went forward with his construction plans or wherever he sold it to, that the road be constructed once in a satisfactory manner, and that it happened close to when the lots were going to be developed. Therefore, it wouldn't make a lot of sense and wouldn't be completely advisable to have the road put in and then sit there for 5 or 10 years.
Following up on that, is it possible to condition this public access waiver upon road construction upon approval of building permits for the lots? Could we get around it that way? In other words, no construction of the road unless the lots could have building permits, and avoid the problem of having a road going nowhere.
And the expense for Mr. Rumley.
Yeah, which could happen.
I believe you could add that as a condition of approval.
See if the applicant's willing to accept
that. Madam Chairman,
sure.
I spoke with Stephen Butler today. He's right about, and we discussed things like this. I cannot adequately get into that property to either lay the services, whatever they might be, without doing some fill. That is not to be construed as building a road, a final built road. Certainly, I would not complete a road before I were to put in water pipes or whatever. You have seen the profile of that land. There has to be some fill to adequately get trucks of any size into the site to build upon the lots. To get services into the roadway, you also have to have some fill. It would not be a completely constructed road.
Madam Chairman,
yes,
I too apologize, but I was not able to visit the site. But from what I understood, it did. I heard that it was quite wet, and I hear reports of cat nine tails and that sort of thing. And I think we want to make sure we get the cart before the horse. I agree with Mr. Mouse that we don't want to put you in the untenable position as a planning board of putting a road in to unbuildable lots, in effect, or lots that couldn't be built unless they had wetlands alteration permits. And even if we went under our old ordinance, which says 5,000 square feet of fill, I still think that we should condition any motion to requiring that those lots will have to be proven that they can be buildable before.
I agree.
I would like to single.
I believe, looking at the materials that were submitted by the applicant and reviewed by the town engineer, that for the first 50 feet that the grade is within 2%.
It is.
But immediately, soon after the 50-foot limit, it starts to drop off, and I believe that's where the 10% grade is.
Madam Chairman, if you see the materials,
see.
This sketch right here.
I see.
It lays out the slope, and it's 2%. For the first 50 feet.
Okay, great.
The 10% is right after that.
Okay, thank you. And also on the letter from the town engineer, I can ask you, Mr. Rumley, the letter indicates that you will be having, you've taken care of, I'm trying to shorten this, that you have taken care of any potential for drainage problem on the abutters land. That would be Mr. Schnell and Mr. Green. What happens to the water when it gets down to your own land? What are you going to do about the drainage there, since that is such a steep slope?
The drainage from these culverts, which were mentioned, continue on and meet with one of three drainage ditches, streams, whatever, that flow across my land right now. They would immediately join water that is draining from somewhere around the 18th green of Purputa Club, and then they flow onward and meet up with water that has been hurried across some of Purputa's other land around the 16th fairway, which they helped out in the woods with a backhoe some 6 or 8 years ago, and then they meet with water that comes from what is now Canterbury, coming from a northerly direction. Then they all go under they go closer to Mr. Green's property and eventually go under Spurlink Avenue and become irrigation water for Ken Maxwell down in his farm before they continue on headed towards Mill Creek.
So you wouldn't have huge puddles there? Obviously it's going someplace.
No, you see there's not going to be any more water moving than what does now.
Now, right.
It might be hurried a little bit by virtue of these culverts for approximately 40 feet, as indicated on the plan, but that would be a situation that would occur only shortly after heavy rainfall. I wouldn't see any additional flowage.
Okay, thank you.
Madam Chair, any further?
Yes.
Could I just ask Mr. Rumley, one of the questions that the neighbors brought up was the concept of buffers and what you might plan for any buffers between their properties and the new. Have you given some thought to that or considered that?
I hadn't given any. I'm not sure what buffers might be desired.
Such things as plantings or fences or anything of that
nature. No, I hadn't.
That would act to screen or be privacy, create privacy between adjoining lots.
No, I noticed that, in fact, the Schnells have themselves, I think, recently put in some evergreen trees in their backyard, and obviously they're free to do that, as I would be free to plant trees on any of my property. These are old size lots, and they're just a little over 10,000 square feet, as are all the lots in that subdivision. And we all, as neighbors in the past, have seemed to get along with what vegetation we grew or did not grow. I have not contemplated.
Just in the interest of creating a pleasant neighborhood, oftentimes it is very desirable to think about a small landscaping plan to enhance the whole.
I agree, and also that sometimes that can be a detriment. I planted some little pine trees to act as a buffer on my property, and now the sun doesn't shine in my yard, so I'm giving serious thought to taking those trees down.
Sequoias.
No, but the pines grow pretty fast.
Any other comments? Judith?
Yes, I was at the site walk, and I've given this particular situation quite a lot of thought. There are some things that, well, I won't say disturb me, but I really thought really quite hard about. One of the things we have here is that you have an old, undeveloped subdivision with the micro lots, as I call them, of the 50s, 100 by 100 or 100 by 80 or 100 by 110, the little tiny ones. And not only was your land wet, but I was really impressed with how close everything is, that this road is almost virtually in the yards of your neighbors. And it's your road, I understand that. Your original plan, large lot. You could go right ahead and keep, as long as I suppose you could get sewer permits, which you probably couldn't, but I have a question with that. I have a question with burdening this particular, I call it a driveway in my mind, not necessarily a roadway, but a driveway. A driveway to these two rear lots that you own. If all of a sudden it turns out that inside of 5 or 10 years you now have 6 or 8 lots that are going to be serviced by it, I have a real problem with that. I have a problem with the fact that this is the last time we'll see you if you're not going to get subdivision approval. All you need now is a building permit. I would like to see, in my own mind, the use of this access waiver limited to those two lots, as well as some other types of contingencies that might be placed on it.
Thank you, Judith.
Madam Chairman?
Yes,
I have
Steve.
A couple other questions. Mr. Armory, the paper street that we see here, do you own the fee ownership of the paper street itself?
I don't understand what you're saying. I'm sorry.
Yes, he does. He does own the fee ownership.
I guess I'm still in question. Visiting the site, there's a small swale, a streamlet that runs through what you now have is lot 16 and 14. Somewhere we have to divert that water around.
I'm sorry, where?
Okay. The stream, the small runoff runs through here.
No, it's
up at this
close.
Corner?
It runs along very close to that corner right here. Right?
Okay. And then it continues somewhere.
This way, and it cuts back down and goes.
Okay. You have some type of provision to continue this water that comes through this culvert around lot 14?
Yes, it flows. That's down here when it gets to, as I said, mentioned, where it meets up the approach from the northern.
Okay.
Any other questions or comments from members of the board? Steve, do you have any comments?
I do, but a lot depends upon what the board wishes to do.
Mm-hmm.
There are some issues that need to be tied down depending on what the board does.
Could I just ask one more question?
Sure.
Mr. Emery, are you planning to make an application for sewers to service these two lots?
I would certainly think so. If whether I sell these lots to somebody else or if I develop it myself, that certainly is going to be a consideration, naturally.
Go ahead, Steve.
Just as the board knows, at this point, it's unlikely that Mr. Armory or whoever owns the lot in the future would be able to acquire a hookup to the public sewer, at least under the current ordinance, because actually neither lot will have frontage on a public street that's served by a public sewer. Both lots are actually off of it. Mr. Armory is going to make the ownership of that strip of land that goes out to Sperling Avenue.
Then I think then the two issues that we discussed should be, I think, put into some kind of motion language, Steve. One is the issue of, is the lot buildable before the road go through. And the other issue is the one that Judy raised on ending the access with these two lots.
So you could add...
I don't know how to word that, but...
I have some language. I think the two lot, under the suggested motion, under condition F, I believe that might cover the issue about...
That's right.
Determining single-family residences on lots 14 and 16.
Right. That does cover it, Steve.
I think that covers it. The other issue, I do have some language that could be worked up that I have prepared in terms of requiring a building permit. And the question I would have for the board is whether or not you would want the condition to deal with one building permit or the acquisition of two building permits as a condition. So what I have here as a possible condition would be that a building permit for at least one of the two lots shall be obtained prior to the start of an access road / driveway construction activity. That would be different. That would be one of the two. So if he was able to show that at least one of the lots could be built upon, he'd get the public, get the building permit, then he could build the roadway.
So,
but until that point. So I guess the question is, would that meet the concerns that the board has?
Sorry about that.
Speak up. It's tough to hear out in the audience.
Oh, okay. Oh.
Hmm.
Oh, it was off. Okay. Sorry. Usually I'm the one telling other people that.
So,
start from the beginning.
So
right?
Could you reread
okay.
that?
Yes.
J, it would be HJ, right? Or are you adding it to something else?
No, it would both of the items, well, the one item I talked about would be added. It could be added after the existing C, but it would read
after C.
That a building permit for at least one of the two lots shall be obtained prior to the start of any access road / driveway construction activity.
Mm-hmm.
Two issues, though. That just limits it to one of the two lots. Second issue is that Mr. Rummery could apply for a permit. And if you've got it, you could start the road. Getting a building permit doesn't necessarily guarantee that construction is going to occur or has to occur or has to finish. So,
Mr. Rummery, you have a question?
Yes, I believe I've heard or read that a building permit is only good for a certain period of time, which sort of requires one to start construction within that period of time. I'm not sure whether you're adding additional verbiage.
The building permit is granted for usually a six-month period of time, and it can be extended, I think, one additional six-month period. I guess the point I was making was that if Mr. Rummery applied for a building permit, it would be only good for 6 months, but if the building permit lapsed, and 3 years later he came back to apply for another one, I'm sure he'd get it. So, but at least what it does, the condition linking the road construction with the building permit, at least would satisfy the board's concern that at least one of the lots is suitable enough that it could be built upon, and therefore that the building inspector would issue a building permit. So at least on one of the two, that condition would then deal with that concern.
Sounds good enough to me. Any other comments? Do I hear a motion?
What about the addition of the, I might have missed the extending of the road to service on the lots?
No, that would be under F.
I think under the current F, it states that this public access waiver shall apply only to single-family residences to be constructed on lots 14 and 16. Another issue which hasn't been brought up, but was mentioned by the town engineer, deals with the fact that the culvert should be 12 inches in diameter. Again, that's something we can maybe add in as another condition. If the board would like, I could read the suggested motion with those two changes.
That would be excellent, Steve.
I'll make the motion. So move, maybe.
Before we vote, though, could I, since Ivan has come in, just so this is all on the up and up, could I ask Steve Etzel to vote on this particular item in Dan Boxer's absence, and then we will ask you for the next item, Judith, okay? Thank you. Okay, go ahead, Steve.
Okay, it's a long one. Be it ordered that the request of Peter Rummery for a public access waiver for two lots, tax map U27, lots 39 and 41, located in the vicinity of 216 Spurwink Avenue, be granted according to section 19-4-2B of the zoning ordinance and the facts presented, subject to the following conditions. A, that the access road slash driveway be maintained and kept clear year-round. B, that any alteration of wetlands that occurs to any portion of the two lots shall be in compliance with the applicable wetlands protection ordinance provisions in place at the time of any such construction. C, that all other pertinent local, state, and federal approvals be obtained by the applicant prior to the start of any access road, driveway, or lot construction activity. Okay, this is a new D, that a building permit for at least one of the two lots shall be obtained prior to the start of any access road, driveway construction activity. E, that the installation of any water and sewer lines shall be undertaken at the time of the initial construction of the access road slash driveway. There's a new F. That the culvert shown on the public access waiver plan shall be 12 inches in diameter and shall be constructed by the applicant at the time of the initial construction of the access road driveway. G, that the present and future owners of lots 14 and 16 be granted the right of access to Spurwick Avenue via the proposed access road driveway in perpetuity. H, that this public access waiver shall apply only to single family residences to be constructed on lots 14 and 16. I, that the requirements of section 19-4-2-B and the above mentioned conditions shall be binding upon the present and future owners of the affected lots. And J, that a covenant incorporating the above mentioned conditions shall be inserted into the deeds of the two lots and the deed for the rest of the property adjacent to said two lots currently owned by Peter Rummery. Said covenant shall be submitted by the applicant for review and approval by the town attorney and town planner and then recorded by the applicant with the Cumberland County Registry of Deeds within 90 days of the granting of this public access waiver. Period.
Very good, Steve. That was moved by Ivan. Is there a second?
A second.
Okay, second by Dick Tinsman. Any discussion? Hearing none.
Madam Chairman, I just want to reiterate a point that was made earlier. This is not a subdivision review. This is a public access waiver. Mm-hmm. The standards for public access waiver are different from a subdivision review in that we look specifically at the access provisions, not at whether the land is buildable, nor do we grant grandfathered rights to build on a piece of property. There
Correct.
Has been no review, technical review of the land itself, and that has to stand the test of other ordinances in the town at the time of the building permit application.
Right, and I'm sure you understand that, don't you, Mr. Rummery?
Yes, ma'am.
Good. Any other comments? Hearing none, I will call for a vote on this motion. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, nay. That's me, nay. So it's one against. Thank you, Mr. Rummery.
Thank you very much.
For Democratic. Okay, I think the microphones are working. Next on our agenda is a public hearing regarding the Highlands at Broad Cove, which is a 22-lot major subdivision bordering Broad Cove and Two Lights Road. Before I open up the public hearing, though, I did receive several telephone calls over the weekend regarding the planning board rules, and I would like to ask Steve Butler if he would inform the public exactly what our process is, because people are very confused about where we are in this particular process regarding this subdivision. But before that, Dan, maybe you would like to explain for the 10th time.
Okay, I'm sorry I was late and missed the
that's quite all
the
right.
First item on the agenda. I would have stayed there, but I wanted to see what my present was. Thank you very much, Marion.
You're welcome.
As I have explained before, being an abutter to this project, I'm abstaining from any deliberation or discussion, but as long as I'm up here to see what my present is, I think I'll just sit and watch.
Okay, Dan. Thank you. And the chair appoints Judith Wyman as a voting member. Okay, now, Steve, perhaps you could just explain to the public as briefly as you can our rather complicated process.
Okay, I'll try, and the microphone is on, I believe.
Can all of you hear? This is our planner, Steve Butler.
In terms of the process, this is considered to be a major subdivision, which means it goes through a two-step process. Right now, the planning board's in the preliminary plan review stage, and the application at the last meeting was found to be complete, and therefore the planning board set the public hearing for this evening. What happens after the public hearing, well, what happens after tonight is two different things. The public hearing can be extended once by the board if the board so if deems it necessary. For instance, if there are a lot of people who still wish to speak and the time ran out in terms of the time allocated. But whenever the public hearing was ended, either tonight or at the next meeting, from that point forward, the board has 30 days to make a decision. And that would either be to approve with conditions, disapprove, or extend its time period to make that decision upon mutual agreement between the planning board and the applicant. That would deal, but at some point, a decision would be made by the planning board regarding preliminary plan approval. The next step would be for the applicant to do whatever needs to be done, then come back for final plan approval and go through that process. During final plan approval, it really involves cleaning up some of the remaining issues that are out there in terms of technical design and review. And at that point, a public hearing is optional for the planning board, and the public hearing can only be called by the board if the proposed subdivision changes substantially between now and the time as when the board looks at it for final plan review. That's it.
Okay, thank you, Steve. I'm sure you all understood every word that he said. Well, again, before I open up the public hearing, I would like to reiterate our rules. If you could please go through the chair, raise your hand. If you are recognized by the chair, please come up to the microphone, state your name and address. If you could kindly not repeat what your neighbors have said, that would be appreciated. And if you could limit your statement to 2 or 3 minutes, you can go over. We're not going to, you know, tap the gavel on you, but those are the rules. And I hope that you won't be nervous. It's very nerve-wracking, I think, to come to a public hearing like this. Perhaps I should just take a few minutes, even though we're running a little late, and maybe I can put you at your ease and tell you about the first public hearing I ever attended. I was 28 years old. That was a century ago. I was very young, had just moved into a house that my husband and I could ill afford in a very nice suburb of New York City with our 3-year-old son. And someone adjacent to us decided that they were going to split an already very small lot in two and build another house there. Well, the Bucks across the street had just put in a bay window, and now they were going to be treated to a garage. And so the whole neighborhood was, you know, in a turmoil over this. And there was going to be a public hearing before the zoning board. And I had never been to such a thing, but was urged by my next-door neighbor, who was a history and government major, and she was quite an activist. I mean, the world needs activists. And she always had a petition or something for us to sign, and she urged me to go and speak at this because she said the more people who show up, the better it is for our cause. So I just worried about it all day because I didn't want to go before the zoning board. And then when I got there to the zoning board meeting, the hall was probably twice as large as this and totally filled with people because there were so many applications that night. And there was standing room only. And anyone standing in the back, please feel free to come up and sit down. So all of my neighbors, our topic was called All of My Neighbors Spoke. And the chairperson kept reiterating, please do not repeat yourself. And it was very frightening because they were all men. Not very many women served on boards in those days, and they were sitting, you know, up high, and it was scary. But at any rate, as I stood in the back, my neighbor turned to me and she said, Marion, go on up there and say something. And I said, but it's already been said. And in her vehemence, she pushed me right into the middle of the aisle there. Well, obviously, if somebody pushed you, the chair would recognize you. Well, everything had already been said, and I thought, my God, with shaking knees, as the chair recognized me, yes, young lady, he said, I had to think of something to say. Well, at that time, I was doing graduate work on my master's degree in English and had an awful lot of quotes at my disposal from Shakespeare and poetry, all of which have dropped out of my mind now. So my knees were knocking, and I approached the bench, and the first mistake I made was to say, good evening, Your Honor. And it occurred to me that I had this quote, and I said, my name is Marion Guthrie. And oh, my voice was just shaking. And I said, you know, I see a universal element to this entire situation, and it brings to mind a poem that I recall by Oliver Goldsmith from the deserted village. And then I boomed out, ill fares the land to hastening ills a prey, where wealth accumulates and men decay. Well, everyone clapped, and, you know, even people who didn't know me who were there for other cases, and I was a heroine in the neighborhood. But the point of the story is, unless you have some good quotes and your neighbor says what you were going to say, please don't repeat it. And the other point of the story is, don't be nervous. We are just regular citizens like you are. Okay? So I will open up the public hearing. We will first hear from the applicant after the public hearing is open. Then we will hear from Steve Butler, who will explain the Normando study done for the town. And then we will hear from as many people from the public who wish to speak. So I will open up the public hearing, and maybe the applicant, Mr. Peter Kennedy, would like to just say a few words, and then we will go on with it.
Good evening. My name is Peter Kennedy, and I'm a partner in the Greater Portland Development Group, who is proposing this 20-lot subdivision. And I brought with me tonight Scott Decker from Squaw Bay Engineers and Bill Bray, who's a traffic engineer. And if you'd like, we'd have Scott Decker give an overview of the proposal, and Scott can take it from there.
Very good. Thank you, Mr. Kennedy.
Thank you. Thank you, Peter. If the planning board would like, I can run through the chronology of the project. Probably everybody here is aware of it already, but...
Yes, just a brief,
just quickly,
very brief presentation, Mr. Dexter.
Approximately 3 months or so ago, we came before the board with the project that is pretty much shown on this site plan. This plan, the brown shaded area here, depicts what was then thought to be the wetland areas down here in this phase one area, up here in this phase two area. This area is in the resource protection zone. Beyond that is the residential zone for the remainder of phase two and all of the phase one area. The dark shaded green area is tree growth. The lighter shaded area is open space with very little tree growth. The dark shaded area here is the roads that we were planning at the time. This subdivision was a 24 lot subdivision with 8 lots in the phase one area and 16 in the phase two area. There was a total of 79 acres, 51 in phase two, 28 in phase one. The lots range from 80,000 square feet to 137,000 square feet. The road system was selected following discussions with public safety people. We felt that there was a need to run a road from Two Lights Road through to the Broad Cove area to provide a connection for public safety vehicles. We did this in both the phase one area, which runs from Two Lights through to Winding Way, and phase two from the Hunts Point Road extension through to Channel View Road with a short cul-de-sac up here in this location. This proposal had no public water or sewer. We were planning to use wells on each lot and individual subsurface wastewater disposal systems on each lot. Storm drainage, pretty much a curb section throughout the entire roadway system with catch basins and for collection of the storm water with outlets at the low points in the road. So very, very little longitudinal subsurface drainage system. This concept, we were planning to transfer about 6 or 7 acres of land, of wetland, in the phase one area and about 13 acres up in the phase two area to the Cape Elizabeth Land Trust. Following that first meeting, we went back to the drawing board and came back with this proposal. This proposal changed several things. The wetlands, for one, following the site walk, we felt the need to take a closer, harder look at smaller pockets of wetland, which we noted during the site walk. So this plan shows some additional wetland areas, but they were roughly flagged in the field and were not tied down real accurately on this drawing. Also changed the road layout in phase one. Instead of coming through the Winding Way, we brought the road up to Hunts Point Road extension. We reduced the number of lots in phase one from 8 lots down to 6 lots for a total of 22 in both phases. We also included a stormwater detention facility over here in this area to attenuate the stormwater flows from this area here. Following this proposal, we came back with a third proposal. This one further refines and defines the wetland areas. You notice they're very erratic along the boundary those wetlands were picked up by field surveys, so are felt to be more accurate than the previously shown wetlands. This proposal also included public water. We're planning at this point to run a water line all of the phase one area and phase two across to, at this point, we're planning to come all the way through to Channelview Road. We also included a 30-foot no-cut buffer strip around the perimeter of the site, which works fine in areas that are wooded. It provides a good 30-foot wooded buffer strip. There were two areas on the site that we felt needed additional vegetation, so we're planning down here on lot two to plant some pine trees between the lot and adjacent property, and again down here in lot three to buffer an existing structure down there. This proposal would also include the requirement for a public access waiver up here in the phase two area. The public road would come in 1,000 feet, and then a public access waiver would be required to service the 5 or 6 lots up in this area. Following this proposal and where we are today, we have this general site plan. This differs a little bit from the one I just showed you in that we've combined 4 lots up here to get just 3 lots, which gives us a total of 14 in phase two. We still have the 6 in phase one for a total of 20 lots. We've included a cul-de-sac here off the end of Channelview Road, about 250 feet. And we'd be requesting a public access waiver for service to lots 12 and 13 over here, and also lot 5 down in the phase 1 area. And I think that about covers the high points and where we are today.
Very good, Mr. Dexter. Thank you very much. As you know, the town of Cape Elizabeth has done its own wetland study, and it is a long-awaited study, and Steve has that information, which I think the applicant might like to hear and the public. So if you could give us that information, which just arrived. Wetland study by Norman Dover.
mark up the two wetland areas that were shown and would somehow come down on this nature. That would be the area, I'm sure the applicant and some other people in the audience will be able to provide more information on that. That's the area. There are also some discrepancies in other parts of the site as well. And those areas are shown in the attached report.
And
yes, the Farm Pond.
Farm Pond, excuse me.
Farm Pond Road would be that, along with the fact that there is an existing roadway that is there, but the proposed roadway would come into that area. Yes.
Very good, Steve. Well, now we will entertain comments and questions from the public, and I think Mr. Kennedy. Maybe you could jot down any questions that the public asks so that you don't have to keep jumping up and answering. After the public has asked their questions and made their comments, we will try to keep track of the questions too. Then perhaps you could address some of them at the end. Would that be all right? So that you don't have to keep getting up and bouncing up and down.
That'd be fine.
Okay.
Would you like to hear from Bill Gray on the traffic study? And those are questions by some of the board members and Steve Butler as to the his previous report.
Well, the way we said, I don't care how we do it. What do you think? I will leave that up to Steve. We're really interested right now in getting the public comment, but we do want to hear from Mr. Bray. But I thought after the public hearing would be the best time when we can ask the question. So, if you know, the people have been dying to speak on this, so we want to give them every opportunity. Anyone from the public? Yes, Peter Plum. Good evening. Welcome back to Cape Elizabeth.
Thank you, Ms. Guthrie. It's been a while since I've been here.
Mm-hmm.
Give me just a minute. We do have a presentation to make to the planning board tonight, and although I recognize that you'd like to shut me off in 2 or 3 minutes, if I keep sort of moving things along, we'll probably get there faster if I
okay.
stay here, if that's all right
sure,
with you.
Sure, sure. Go ahead.
I have been asked to represent a group composed, I'd say it's a loose group of more than a dozen neighborhood families and residents of the area to bring to the attention of the planning board their specific concerns about this project. We're here not to nitpick all of the little things that many people have found to be wanting here. That's not the purpose of our presentation tonight. What we wish to do with you is to highlight those few issues as we see being the gut issues of this project and where it goes from here. By way of a little background, although Mr. Decker had, Scott Decker indicated that they came in 3 months ago, this project began here several years ago, and 2 years ago at least, in 1987, it was an 11-lot project. Then it mushroomed into the 24 lots, and now it's shrunk back a little bit, most recently down to the 20 lots. And while it's called the Highlands at Broad Cove, from what we have been able to learn about this over the past 2 or 3 weeks that we've worked quite intensively on it, it really should be called the Lowlands at Broad Cove. And that is really the core of what is going on here. There are four issues that we want to address you on tonight. The first is the wetlands issue, which is found scattered through your ordinance, but governed in part by the subdivision standards, subparts O and U of 16-3.1 of your ordinance. We too have done a wetland study to follow up on the Normando work, and the people who did that are here tonight, and they will have their own presentation for you in just a minute. Secondly, we wish to address the soil suitability. This project is proposing subsurface septic sewage disposal, and notwithstanding the fact that it is proposed to have a public water supply, it nevertheless is governed by the state standards, which are cranked into your ordinance for compliance purposes. and we have taken the reports which have been filed by the applicant to date and done some hydrogeological work on them to see whether or not the lots would be able to pass muster at the state level where this project must ultimately wind up. And we have some bad news for you in that respect, but we present that in just a minute also. Third, this project, while we recognize your new comprehensive plan is not yet in effect and so does not really govern it, the comprehensive plan wouldn't govern it anyway, but does represent the collective thinking of the town at this point, it would seem to me. And so we do have some specific issues related to the comprehensive plan and how this project fits within that that we wish to address. And finally, we do wish to address the traffic questions that are, and traffic safety, I lump them all in together, that are raised by this particular project, because we do think that the information that is presented, while perfectly acceptable in terms of traffic counts, what Mr. Bray has done and his predecessor, Mr. Eaton, several years ago now, that there are some serious flaws in what has been presented to the planning board to date. So what I would like to do first is introduce to you the two experts who come both from the firm of Timpson, Sheps, and Peters. First of all, Mr. Colin Peters, who is a wetlands specialist, has undertaken in our behalf to do as preliminary a wetland study as he could and still make sense of it, because we too agree with the Normado analysis. It's very hard to do anything, mm-hmm. even though there are standards you can apply. It is hard to do anything and to know what really is going on when the snow's on the ground and mm-hmm. it's all frozen up. So what we would propose to do first, however, is show you what we have done, and since we have double-checked it with the Normando people, I think you'll find that we're saying very much the same things. Colin, would you come up and introduce yourself? This is Cole Peters from the firm of Timpson, Sheps, and Peters. I have his resume here, which I was copying up in your file.
Thank you.
As has been said, my name is Colin R. Peters. I am a vice president at Timpson, Sheps, and Peters. We have offices in Portland and Hollowell, Maine.
Mr. Peters, do you think you could speak into the microphone?
Yes.
Thank you.
As has been said by Peter Plum, I do the wetland work for our firm. And as has been said, we have been retained by concerned citizens in the Broad Cove neighborhood to conduct a review of wetlands on this project. My work has entailed reviewing reports prepared by Harold Brown that deal with wetlands on the site, and in addition, a brief site walk on Friday of last week where I reviewed the wetland boundaries in conjunction with alternate B of the proposed project. In the course of conducting this review, I made use of a wetland boundary delineation method that has been developed by the Corps of Engineers, and more recently it has been agreed upon by four federal agencies, the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers, the United States EPA, U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service, and U.S. Soil Conservation Service. This wetland boundary delineation method takes into account three parameters, and it's sometimes referred to as the unified approach or the multi-parameter approach, the three parameters being vegetation, soils, and hydrology. In reviewing Harold Brown's report, he too took into account these three same parameters. And as I suspect, the Normando company did the same in their review. So with that standard technique, I then walked the site to verify and examine areas of wetland shown on the plan. Generally speaking, the areas are shown, as you see here in green. But then, as has been described in the summary of the Normando project, I had found other areas where I felt there was evidence of wetland plant communities.
I want to hold this up for you one second.
qualified business up for the planning board. Can you see this, Mark, the members of the planning board?
Mm-hmm. Is it better over here?
Generally, this is the same case that appears underneath. And what I've done is outline in green the wetlands that were referred to in this plan, also in green. But then in addition, I've shown in areas of red where I felt there were other areas of wetland plant communities based on observations that I made. And this resulted from viewing species of vegetation which are defined as being either facultative wet or facultative indicators of wetland. And what those terms refer to is the fidelity of the plant to occur in a wetland plant community. These same plants, this same fidelity rating was used in the wetland report prepared by Carol Brown. So that we're looking at the same apples and apples and not apples and oranges. And so in these areas, where I felt the plants exist, and another parameter that was used, particularly in this area, was frozen water being a hydrology parameter. So that, in summary, where the wetlands would occur are expansions of wetland areas that have been presently delineated. But in addition, in some places quite sizable, particularly on what would be lots 2, 3, and 4, so that the significance of the occurrence of these wetland areas would be one that they would occur in portions of the access road, but secondly, fairly extensive on these two lots in the southern part of the site on phase one. So that in concurrence with the recommendation of the Normandale report, I would recommend that the wetland boundaries be re-examined for better weather conditions in these specific areas that I have shown in red and elsewhere where Normandale may want discrepancies based on that further detailed examination.
Mr. Peters, if I may ask you, the impact of finding wetlands in such a large extent, for example, on lots 2, 3, and 4, could be what?
Well, as has been discussed earlier in speaking, there are wetland ordinance either existing or being proposed here in the community. A filling was to occur in these areas. There would be some sealing or filling associated with that. Secondly, there would be other levels of jurisdiction over these wetland areas, notably with the state DEP under the Natural Resources Protection Act, which regulates both floodplain wetlands and freshwater wetlands. So that would be another permitting process, and at the federal level, the Corps of Engineers would have regulation over impacts to wetlands under the provisions of the Clean Water Act.
Now, Mr. Peters, when, in your opinion, would be the most appropriate time to do a proper wetland survey for this site?
And I think due to the criteria required to be looked at, would be in a period of no snow cover, when the ground is unfrozen, and when there's a well-established vegetative cover, and that these are the three parameters that are considered by the delineation method.
So realistically, you're looking at late May, June, sometime like that.
Yes,
coming here. Thank you very much. Did you prepare a report for the planning board?
Yes, I have. It's in the form of a three-page letter.
I would submit to you now.
Hey.
The report, which does have a condensed copy of that map, which we just showed you, and my Facebook lawyer, my secretary, traced it all out of the red.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you, Cole.
Thank you very much.
The next issue we would like to address is the question of this soil suitability, particularly the question of the discharge of nitrate and nitrogen at the borders, which is a standard imposed by the state and which is incorporated by reference in your own ordinance under Section 15 of your sewer ordinance. And for that, we ask Mr. Barry Timpson, who has his expertise in that area, to advise us. And Barry, if you come forward at this time to discuss that. Mr. Timpson is the
president of Timpson, Jeff, and Peters, and his
thank you.
Madam Chairperson, members of the board, my name is Barry Timpson. I am a Maine certified geologist, and I'm the second third of the partnership in Timpson, Sheps, and Peters. The third partner is a resident of Cape Elizabeth. We were hired by the same group of people who are concerned about wetlands on the site to look at the standards for disposal of subsurface sewage throughout the subdivision as proposed on the plan dated November of 1989. It's my understanding that since then you have a new plan which has removed one lot, and I believe that was submitted either yesterday or early this morning. We also reviewed all of the existing information submitted by the applicant, including soils logs and the soils map, to determine some of the variables that one uses to predict the nitrate-nitrogen concentration of leachate from the subsurface sewage systems. Now, the Cape Elizabeth Sewer Ordinance states that not only must local ordinance be followed, but all federal and state regulations be observed in the disposal of subsurface sewage. At the present time, the Maine Department of Environmental Protection has certain standards for subdivisions coming under the site law, and it's my understanding that this subdivision at the present time, as proposed, would come under the site law. It's greater than 20 acres. They have guidelines that any subdivision under the site law which proposes the disposal of subsurface sewage, regardless of whether the proposed subdivision will be on public water or on individual wells, and regardless of whether the neighborhood is on public water or individual wells, must meet certain standards with respect to their hydrogeologic impacts. This subdivision would easily fall under a subdivision which, on which a hydrogeologic assessment would be required, and I would give you three of them. One, where any lot has soils shallower than 3 feet to bedrock, where any disposal system is proposed for less than 300 feet from the subdivision boundary, and for any subdivision or any lot within the subdivision that is less than 2 acres. So that the entire subdivision then would come under what DEP would consider having to do a hydrogeologic assessment. The standard hydrogeologic assessment looks at the nitrogen content of the leachate at the boundary of the subdivision. Using the applicant's materials, we have calculated the concentration of nitrate nitrogen at the subdivision boundary for all of the lots. Now, mind you, that was in the November plan. There is one change in that they have removed one lot, and therefore there is one change in our determination. But using a standard technique, using variables which the DEP dictates, and using other figures which would be considered liberal and in favor of the applicant, we determine the nitrogen concentration of subsurface sewage systems located in the most advantageous position which the applicant submitted test pits for. By most advantageous, we took a test pit that was located the furthest away from a property from the boundary of the subdivision if there were two on the same lot. Our calculations show that the following lots cannot meet DEP subdivision boundary nitrate nitrogen concentration standards. Lots 1N, 2N, 10N, 11N, 12N, 13N, 14N, and what used to be 15N is now no longer 15N. We'll strike that. 4S, 5S, and 6S. The concentration standard of the property of the boundary of the subdivision cannot be met whether this is a conventional system or a peat line system, a peat line system being used to cut the initial concentration of nitrate nitrogen as it flows from the leach field into the soil and is used in places where soil conditions are not optimal for the disposal of subsurface sewage. I would like to say that it is, we did make these calculations based on assumptions. We did not go on the lot. Many of the assumptions that we made would be in favor of the applicant. We suspect that when one does some investigations of the groundwater on the site, that the background nitrate concentration could be higher than what we have allowed. We basically assigned the lowest value for background nitrate nitrogen concentration. We would recommend at this point in time that regardless of the number of lots that are proposed by the applicant, whether at this time or in the future, that the planning board absolutely require a hydrogeologic assessment of the applicant for this subdivision. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Timpson.
Barry, did you prepare a report Timpson. For the use of the planning board that summarizes your statements?
Yes, I did. I prepared a two-page letter dated December 18, 1989.
Thank you. Thanks again, Mr. Timpson.
The prior two witnesses presented you with evidence that either 12 or 13 of these lots, out of the 20 lots, is in serious jeopardy, are in serious jeopardy of being unable to comply with the basic standards now in effect in this town. Now, the next issue we would like to address briefly has to do with this question of the comprehensive plan. And while, as I said a minute ago, we recognize that the comprehensive plan is not the law of the town, nevertheless, it does represent what would appear to be the best collective thinking of the members of the community at this time. And we will have a couple of witnesses in a minute who have great background in this question of the comprehensive plan, but I would like to quote from Part 6, Objective 6 of the Comprehensive Plan of 1989, which says that we should direct future growth to areas best suited for development and away from marginal and undevelopable land. State growth management law and guidelines require communities to identify rural protection areas and growth areas within their municipal boundaries. According to the new law, rural areas are those sections of a municipality that are generally unsuitable for development due to environmental conditions. Growth areas, on the other hand, are those sections of the community that do not have environmental development constraints and are best suited for new development. Now, while acknowledging that this area of the community has been the subject of growth, I don't think there's any question that what is on Hunt's Point today would not be approvable by this planning board today. Recognizing that, this area, on those two points that we've just outlined to you in itself, is at best marginal for development. And so we ask you to look in your deliberations here at where this thing does fit in the overall scheme of things for future development of the town of Cape Elizabeth. The last issue I want to just briefly touch on is the question of traffic. and the safety issues relating from the construction of a new road running from Two Lights Road up into Hunts Point Road, and a new series here, but primarily the impact of what happens when you make this now into a thoroughfare and a great grand loop running back down around through Broad Cove Road and out again. And before you hear from the neighborhood witnesses, I would point out what we think is a serious flaw in the traffic studies that have been presented to you to date. And that's this. If you look at what has been presented, all of the calculations are based upon existing turns onto the existing Broad Cove Road and what the projected turns would be given the built-up, i.e., at the time these studies were done, 24 lots. And there's no quarrel at all with the numbers that Bill Bray comes up with. I mean, how many traffic trips are going to be generated by 20 or 24 lots is a finite number, and it's quite clear that it would be very hard to say that the addition of 20 new houses here is going to do too much to any one of these roads. As one witness is going to say, it's going to make a runway out of Hunts Point Road extension, but that's not the issue so far as traffic studies are concerned. The problem, however, is this, that as all of you know, this Two Lights Road is increasingly congested by thousands and thousands and thousands of tourists, particularly in the summertime. And it is incredible to me that at least on the text of the three reports you have here, the most recent one being dated August 29, 1989, the impact of the tourist traffic coming down, Sunday drivers, or whenever, all summer long and any other time of the year, and the new turns that will be generated by that traffic, not the 20 lots in the subdivision, but the traffic that's going to come down here just to see what it's like. And our basic recommendation to you on that issue is to ask the traffic man to go back and figure that out, because there are tens of thousands of cars coming down on Two Lights Road. Some of those are going to turn down here and make the loop, because it's going to be a very attractive looking place to drive in. Now, with that, I would like to ask the first of our witnesses to come forward and from the neighborhood and explain to you what is really on the minds of the folks out here. And Gina D'Angelo, if you would come forward and stand here at the microphone and address the issues relating to traffic, if you would.
Thank you, Mr. Plum. Hi.
My name is Gina D'Angelo, and I live at 75 Hunts Point Road, which is right here. I came here tonight to speak to the planning board about a concern that is of utmost importance to me, and that is the impact that this development will make on the safety of my two young children and the other 20 preschool and school-age children that live on Hunts Point Extension. I'm going to refer to the plan here. This plan proposes that two roads be developed. One road will end in a cul-de-sac, which will service approximately 8 new homes. The other road, like Peter said, will open up a thoroughfare and connect Hunts Point Road out to Two Lights Road. This will greatly affect the amount of traffic that we have on Hunts Point Extension and throughout the neighborhood. At the present time, the traffic is limited mostly to residents who live on our street, because once people come through here and know that there's no way out, usually people don't travel through anymore. But with an increase in the 20 new homes, plus the traffic that we will get from Two Lights coming through our neighborhood, this will make a great impact. And at this point, I want to further emphasize this by showing you an aerial view of Hunts Point Road. We have it in black and white. We also have it in color.
Here.
come on, come over there. I'll stand right here.
Well, you can see on this photo, this is Hunts Point Road, and it does look like a hairway manicure, but you can see it in the color photo here.
It looks that way in both black and white and color.
I saw that on your site.
Yeah.
But from this point out to the ocean, it's approximately 1 mile, and it's an unobstructed straightaway, wide and flat, and it can support traffic traveling at approximately 50 miles per hour if they were here to do so on that road. And I feel that opening up a thoroughfare and a through road out to a road like this would be a great detriment to the safety of our children. And that is why I am here tonight, and because of these concerns for the safety of my family and others, I cannot support the development. Thank you. Thanks, Peter. I keep thanking you, but you're not finished.
Not quite finished. Yeah. We're getting there. Okay. The next witness I'd like to call upon is Henry Berry.
Madam Chairman and members of the board, my name is Henry Berry, and I live on Two Lights Road. And I've been there 28 years, and I'd just like to, without wanting to repeat what the others have said, I'd like to emphasize that Peter Plum, I think, has an excellent point when he says that the amount of traffic that is generated along the Two Lights Road by the State Park, by the Fessenden Road traffic that comes up in the early spring till the late fall, and any time there's any kind of a sea swell with breakers for the people to go out and see, draws a tremendous amount of traffic, and he is not exaggerating. And I think that the character of the neighborhood will be substantially changed by this development. And we have, of course, lived there for years in what has become a fairly stable neighborhood, what has always been a fairly stable neighborhood in the Two Lights Road area on the corner of Hannaford Cove Road. Unfortunately, my driveway is the first one down the road, so that's where they all turn when they want to go the other way. I foresee the same phenomenon taking place with the Jordan farm, because I go back to the time when Grandpa Jordan used to sell pumpkins to my children. And that, I understand, is a long time ago, and the neighborhood is changing, the town is changing. We're not going to impede progress. But I think that the impact on the neighborhood of this road going through with this extra traffic cannot be emphasized enough, because the cars that go down there in the summer are in the thousands. And Peter's not exaggerating. It's true. I used to sit there in the backyard or in the front yard, and there'd be an occasional car. Now there's a steady stream both ways. I think the fastest car that ever went down there was Lyndon Johnson and Lady Bird in their limousine, but they had some sort of diplomatic immunity. But they've been joined, and that. We do have an awful lot of cars that go down there that are tourists, as Peter says, people who are traveling up and down that road and are going to want to go back to Portland by the scenic route. And I think that's a very valid consideration that probably has not been taken into consideration when you say there's going to be 20 houses and 40 cars. Every two-car family, so there's an extra 40 cars going up and down the Two Lights Road. And I think it's a lot more impact than that, based upon the Hannaford Cove Road and Two Lights experience that we have lived and seen with our own eyes. As a matter of fact, on one occasion, I don't want to take more than my 2 minutes, but on one occasion, I saw a police cruiser with a flashing blue light and a sawhorse at the state park to prevent any more cars as an emergency situation from going down to the restaurant, the expanded non-conforming use at the end of the Two Lights Road. Funny. And I asked the policeman, why are you there? And he said, because no more cars can go down there because it's choked and there isn't any more room and it's an emergency. And that can happen, that kind of traffic congestion can happen when there's a colorful surf that can attract a lot of people who want to take pictures and who want to see it. And I just see that 40 cars out of 20 homes is not the full picture here. So I ask you to take that into consideration. I can't support the plan for that reason.
Thank you, Mr. Barry.
Next, I'd like to call on Steve Wright.
Good evening, Madam Chairwoman and members of the board. I just had a few other comments that I thought were significant in this application that have not been made relative to the traffic issue, and I won't repeat what has been said, but a few points that I think need to be brought up. If you've done the sidewalk, and I know most of you have, you will see that the Hunts Point Road extension, as well as all of Hunts Point Road, in fact, all of Broad Cove, does in fact have no sidewalks. That represents an exposure to us because I am one of the parents of the children that do play on the street. The number of cars that have been talked about, the speed at which those cars currently pass up and down on Hunts Point Road is very disturbing to me. Without sidewalks that I think are critical to keep the children off the road, they end up being forced into the area, or the area children need to basically play on the street. Another issue that I wanted to just overview quickly is there really are no recreation areas in the subdivision, in the current Broad Cove subdivision, whether that be on Broad Cove Road itself, Hunts Point Road, Winding Way, etc. There are really no areas within that whole subdivision that I'm aware of that are available public property for the residents and their children to play on, again, being forced to play on the street. Another point that I just wanted to make very quickly, the Hunts Point Road extension, as you know today, is in fact a cul-de-sac. I think I speak for the majority of the residents on Hunts Point Road extension that we bought homes in that area, not only because of the quality of the neighborhood, but just as importantly, the fact that it was a cul-de-sac, and that represents a safety factor to us, not only for public safety, because we do think it's a benefit to have only one access, but it's also a benefit in that limits the amount of traffic that goes up and down the road. The last issue I will just emphasize is that of speeding. There is, in fact, a stop sign in the middle of Hunts Point Road where Winding Way meets it. Cars come down Hunts Point Road extension, and they're not the residents, because we are sensitive to the fact that there are a lot of kids on the streets. They go up Hunts Point Road, turn around, look at the nice Sunday driving houses, and come back down and ignore that stop sign. And I'm sure that they continue down, they go through Salt Spray Road and out Broad Cove. And I think the residents of Broad Cove, in fact, Broad Cove Road, would concur without question that excessive speeding occurs no matter what you do on all of Broad Cove Road. I'm sure that the residents of Broad Cove Road would agree with that issue. Adding additional traffic does not solve their problem. In fact, I think it makes it worse. Continued traffic going through Broad Cove Road at excessive speeds. Final comment, I just wanted to make clear that I think there's a very strong issue that should be brought up here, and that is the issue of wildlife. I've got a beautiful view of my backyard of, on any given weekend when I'm home, deer and fox that actually are in my backyard, and I'm really concerned of the impact on the wildlife to those areas that would then be developed. That's my comments. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Wright, before you leave, you obviously live on Hunts Point Extension, but what is your number there? We want your address.
I am number 66 Hunts Point Road.
66. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Steve. One of the issues that's unresolved, or at least appears to be unresolved in your file, as a correspondence with the town attorney, is the status of these two access points to the either side of the existing Hunts Point Road extension. Whether or not this subdivision plan needs to be amended, it may well be a mechanical thing, but I would flag that for the planning board, that I'm not sure that issue has been resolved in any concrete way at all. Now, I indicated a minute ago that I would like to revisit the question of the comprehensive plan. At this point, I'd like to call on Mr. Jim Bourque to come up and give the board a couple of comments about that issue.
Mr. Hunter brings up a couple of issues that in two areas of this report, he says the soils are marginal. Mm-hmm. One of the items in the wetlands area, one of the items in the comprehensive plan does say we're very concerned with marginal areas. Development should be steered away from them. Also, just personally, I've attended a lot of the meetings and workshops, and the areas of wetlands, again, it's a very important issue on the comprehensive plan. Every meeting I come to, the wetlands area changes. It's very interesting. I would say until these two issues are nailed down, I don't think I could support the development at this time. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Burke.
I'd now like to call Mr. Tim Thompson. My name is Tim Thompson, and I'm a Broad Cove resident. I live at 6 Pine Ridge Road. And in trying to think about what I was going to talk on the subject this evening, they did my thinking for me and told me to cover the comprehensive plan. It's also an area that I was quite concerned about. And in doing my research, I went back to the 1980 comprehensive plan, because that's what's, I guess, in force at this time.
Correct.
However, I think Peter makes a nice point in that the comprehensive plan that we have in draft form at this point does represent the thinking of the individuals that have been assigned to this project right now, and I think it's the current thinking of the town based on surveys that we've received. But in going back and reviewing the comprehensive plan of 1980, I think there's lots of material in there that gives us all the ammunition we need. Not ammunition, probably not a good word. But certainly gives us the supporting documents that we could, and I've highlighted a few areas, and it's interesting how we talk, the comprehensive plan of 1980 covers a lot of the same kind of issues and concerns that we have today. And it even mentions back then that study after study after study has been covered on these areas, such as open space. Open space was as much a concern back in 1980 when this document was put together as it is for us today. They some of the specific recommendations that they make back then, I'm sure if you look at the comprehensive plan today, they're even more important today. But some of the things that we talk about, they specifically look at open space ratios. And I know I don't need to be telling the planning board this, but I think for the public, it's valuable to know that they define open space as space that's usable. I'm not at all convinced that this space that's being designated as open space is going to be too usable for my children or the children of this development. And one of the things that they specifically talk about is that open space does not include land occupied with non-recreational buildings, roads, right-of-ways, nor does it include yards or lots of single or multifamily dwellings. It's open space should be left in the natural state except in the case of recreational uses. Open space is designed to be utilized, and as many of you can attest, unless you want to give a course to the young children in the neighborhood of walking in hip boots, some of that area is not going to be too usable. Next, I went to the Cape Elizabeth Greenbelt Plan of 1988, and it's remarkable. There's still some of the same issues in that there are in 1980 and there are today. They talk about open space in here as critical concerns. They identify again this area as an area that the town should speak to the owners of that area and try to convince them and encourage them to maintain an open space. They talk about cluster housing way back in, it's amazing, in the fall issue of 1989 of Maine Growth Management News, they talk about cluster housing as a new concept. Well, we were talking about and we have, back in 1980, we're way ahead of our time. But I think as identified in the current comprehensive plan, we knew about it then. There's been a little of it done, but not nearly enough, and it's something we should really focus on. We need to try to use open space. And again, in the areas that are identified, and this is area, there's a great scenic area that's identified in this plan.
And then the new comprehensive plan, there's a couple of areas that I wanted to cover, that they even mention the Broad Cove development and identify it. They target it as an area that's in great need. It's an area that has no parks for the people. I think Steve Wright made a great point in that the place that's designated now for our children to play is in the streets. And obviously we don't want that to continue, especially if there's going to be traffic coming through with people that, the people in Broad Cove today, the parents in Broad Cove today are well aware that there's a great number of children in that area, especially on Hunts Point Road. There's, I think the number is 26, there's one child for every house lot that's being proposed. And that's something that is of a great concern of mine also. So the traffic issue is one other thing that is a major concern. But the plan that's it's not in place, just like the wetlands ordinance is not in place, but it does represent the better thinking of the better people with the better brains that have been put in charge of putting this plan together. And again, they talk about the same kinds of things. Again, avoiding at all costs developing marginal lands. Refers to, again, this scenic area that's of so much concern to us. The town, therefore, is at the point where the adoption of land use controls can and must effectively and readily observe the problem of open space. It's not something that we're not aware of. But I've taken up my time, and I do appreciate and thank you for yours. And I would hope that we now have all the tools in place. We can utilize these tools to link us to the future, or we can ignore them and chain us to the past.
Thank you, Mr. Thompson.